In this presentation, we are going to learn about the definition, classification of respiratory failure, distinction between acute and chronic respiratory failure, the pathophysiological causes of respiratory failure, how we diagnose, what are the causes of respiratory failure, clinical presentation, investigation and management, as well as complication and prognosis of respiratory failure. Start with the definition. It is a clinical condition in which the partial pressure of oxygen is less than 60 millimeter of mercury while breathing room air, or partial pressure of carbon dioxide is more than 50 millimeter of mercury. So basically it is a failure of oxygenation and carbon dioxide elimination, which is due to dysfunction of one or more essential components of respiratory systems like chest wall abnormalities, airway disorders, alveolar capillary units, pulmonary circulation, nerve, central nervous system or brain stem. Respiratory failure can be acute and chronic or acute on chronic, and it is broadly classified into type 1 respiratory failure and type 2 respiratory failure. Classification of respiratory failure. The type 1 respiratory failure is the hypoxemic respiratory failure, and it is defined as the partial pressure of oxygen is less than 60 millimeter of mercury with normal or decreased partial pressure of carbon dioxide, and it is associated with acute diseases of lung like acute lung injury, pulmonary edema, pneumonia, pulmonary hemorrhage or lung collapse. Type 2 respiratory failure is defined as an hypercapnic respiratory failure in which, along with hypoxemia, patient have partial pressure of carbon dioxide raised to more than 50 millimeter of mercury. And the causes of type 2 respiratory failure is drug overdose, neuromuscular diseases, chest wall deformity, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and bronchial asthma. Type 3 respiratory failure is perioperative respiratory failure, and it is due to increased atelectasis due to low functional residual capacity in the setting of abnormal abdominal wall mechanics. Type 3 respiratory failure is usually due to the residual anesthesia effect and postoperative pain or abnormal abdominal mechanics, which contribute to decreasing functional residual capacity and progressive collapse of the dependent lung. Type 3 respiratory failure often result in type 1 or type 2 respiratory failure, and it can be ameliorated by anesthetic or operative technique, posture, incentive spirometry, post-operative analgesia, and attempts to lower the intra-abdominal pressure. Now coming to the type 4 respiratory failure. Type 4 respiratory failure is usually secondary to the cardiovascular instability, and it is described in patients who are intubated or ventilated in the process of resuscitation due to shock, like cardiogenic shock, septic shock or hypovolemic shock. Now, how to differentiate between the acute and chronic respiratory failure? Acute respiratory failure is developed over minutes to hours, and there is a low pH, and the decrease in pH is quickly to less than 7 point, for example in pneumonia, while the chronic respiratory failure develop over the period of days, which result in slightly decrease in pH and increase in bicarbonate. Patient have polycythemia and signs of poor pulmonary, for example in patient with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Now, what are the pathophysiologic causes of hypoxemic respiratory failure? So basically there are four causes. Number one is hypoventilation. Number two is weak ventilation perfusion mismatch. Number three is shunt, and number four is diffusion abnormality. So the number one cause is hypoventilation. It usually occur when there is decrease in ventilation to less than 4 to 6 liter per minute. And the causes may be depression of central nervous system from the drugs, or neuromuscular disease of respiratory musculature. In hypoventilation, the AA gradient, the alveolar arterial gradient, is normal. Number two cause is ventilation perfusion mismatch. It is the most common cause of hypoxemia. Low ventilation perfusion ratio may occur either from due to decreased ventilation secondary to airway or interstitial lung disease, or over perfusion in the presence of normal ventilation, for example in pulmonary embolism. What is the normal VQ ratio? It is 0.8. And administration of 100% oxygen eliminate the hypoxemia. The third important cause of hypoxemic respiratory failure is the shunt, in which the deoxygenated blood bypasses the ventilated alveoli and mix with oxygenated blood, which result in hypoxemia. Even if you give 100% oxygen by inhalation, the hypoxemia persists and there is an extreme VQ mismatch. Blood passes through part of respiratory system that receive no ventilation, either due to obstruction or fluid accumulation. And it is not correctable with 100% oxygen. Causes of shunt could be intracardiac, pulmonary. Intracardiac is due to right to left shunt, like in case of Ferrer's tetralogy or Eisenmenger syndrome. The pulmonary causes of shunting include atriovenous malformation, pneumonia, pulmonary edema, atelectasis collapse, pulmonary hemorrhage, pulmonary contusion. The fourth important cause of hypoxemic respiratory failure is diffusion abnormality. It is a less common cause. The distance between the alveoli and pulmonary capillary is 1 to 2 cm. With the diffusion abnormality, there is an increased distance between the alveoli, which could be due to abnormality of the alveolar membrane, or decrease in number of alveoli, like in case of emphysema. And it is correctable with 100% oxygen. The causes of diffusion abnormality could be ARDS, fibrotic lung disease, severe emphysema, and recurrent pulmonary emboli. Now we discuss about the pathophysiological causes of hypercapnic respiratory failure. And it is usually occur due to imbalance between the ventilatory supply and demand, or increased dead space ventilation. So, alveolar hyperventilation and VQ mismatch can also cause the hypercapnic respiratory failure, because ventilation is not adequate to eliminate the carbon dioxide and it leads to respiratory acidosis. For example, in case narcotic overdose, GBS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and asthma. The second most important cause of hypercapnic respiratory failure is increased dead space ventilation. Dead space is a ventilation. It is a volume of air that is inhaled, but it doesn't take part in the gas exchange, because it either remain in the conductive airway or reaches the alveoli that are not perfused or poorly perfused. So it leads to increased work of breathing and insufficient energy to overcome the resistance. Ventilation falls, partial pressure of carbon dioxide increased, and it leads to respiratory acidosis. So how you diagnose the respiratory failure? History is the most important part, and it gives you clue about the diagnosis and the cause of the respiratory failure. For example, sepsis, which is usually suggested by the fever and chills. If there is history of cough, sputum production or chest pain, patient may have pneumonia. Pulmonary embolism, which may be suggested by sudden onset of shortness of breath or chest pain. COPD exacerbation can be a cause of respiratory failure, and it is suggested by the history of heavy smoking, cough, sputum production, cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Patient gave you history of chest pain, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, and orthopnea. Non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, it is suggested by the presence of risk factor including sepsis, aspiration and blood transfusion. Accompanying sensory abnormalities or symptoms of weak necks may suggest neuromuscular respiratory failure. There is also patient can give history of ingestion of drugs or toxins. Inhalation exposure history may help to diagnose asthma, aspiration. The next step towards the diagnosis examination. Patient may give signs of hypotension, like poor perfusion, which may be due to severe sepsis or massive pulmonary embolism. Hypertension usually with signs of poor perfusion suggest cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Or on examination, you may find wheezing, which suggests airway obstruction like bronchospasm, fixed upper or lower airway pathology, secretions, pulmonary edema, or cardiac asthma. On examination, you may find stridor, which suggests upper airway obstruction. Elevated jugular venous pressure suggests right ventricular dysfunction due to accompanying pulmonary hypertension, or tachycardia and arrhythmia may be the cause of cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So now we will discuss about the clinical symptoms and signs of hypoxemia and hypercapnia. Patient may have dyspnea and cyanosis in case of hypoxemia, confusion, somnolence, fits, tachycardia, arrhythmias, tachypnea, use of accessory muscles, nasal flaring, recession of intercostal muscles, polycythemia, pulmonary hypertension, poor pulmonary right side heart failure, CNS depression, and when there is a heart tries to compensate, there is increased heart rate and cardiac output. And if there is no compensation, there is leads to increased low oxygen. And finally, shock and multi-organ failure. The signs of hypercapnia include increased cerebral blood flow and CSF pressure, headache, atherosclerosis, papilloedema, warm extremities, collapsing pulse, acidosis, decreased pH and increased lactic acid. Causes of type 1 respiratory failure may be due to abnormalities of alveoli or alveolar unit failure in case of cardiogenic or non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, aspiration pneumonia, collapse, flooding of the alveoli with the edema, blood, pus, or aspiration, or fibrosis, associated with intrapulmonary shunt and increased work of breathing. Other cause would be pulmonary vasculature failure, like in case of pulmonary embolism and pulmonary hypertension. Now we discuss the causes of type 2 respiratory failure. It could be due to central nervous system depression, and depression of the neural drive to breath may be due to the brain stem tumor or vascular abnormality, overdose of narcotic sedative, makes edema, chronic metabolic alkalosis or neuropathies. It could be acute or chronic hyperventilation and The other cause of type 2 respiratory failure is the disorder of peripheral nervous system, respiratory muscles and chest wall, which leads to inability to maintain a level of minute ventilation appropriate for the rate of carbon dioxide production. For example, in case of GBS, muscular dystrophy, myasthenia gravis, or chest wall or pleural space failure in case of kyphosclerosis, morbid obesity, pneumothorax, hydrothorax, hemothorax, and which leads to hypoxemia as well as hypercapnia. The other important cause of type 2 respiratory failure is abnormality of the airway, which may be upper airway involvement or lower airway involvement in case of asthma, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and cystic fibrosis. So there is a list of common causes for hypoxemic respiratory failure as well as hypercapnic respiratory failure. So what are the causes of hypoxemic respiratory failure? As you already discussed, chronic bronchitis, emphysema, pneumonia, pulmonary edema, pulmonary fibrosis, asthma, pneumothorax, pulmonary embolism, pulmonary hypertension, bronchiectasis, ARDS, fat embolism, kyphoscoliosis, obesity, cyanotic congenital heart disease. These are all the causes of hypoxemic respiratory failure. And hypercapnic respiratory failure in chronic bronchitis, emphysema, severe asthma, drug overdose, poisoning, myasthenia gravis, polyneuropathy, polyomyelitis, primary alveolar hypoventilation, obesity, hypoventilation syndrome, pulmonary edema, acute respiratory distress syndrome and mixed edema, hydrocervical cord. Other investigation include microbiology, like the culture of the blood, urine, body fluid and sputum or tracheal cultures, and if the patient is not producing sputum, you can go for the bronchoalveolar lavage. Chest radiograph is important, and it helps to identify the chest wall, pleural or parenchymal lung disease, and to distinguish between the disorder that cause primarily ventilation perfusion mismatch or shunt. पेशेंट विद नमूनिया और पल्मोनरी एडिमा. ईसीजी इज इम्पॉर्टेंट इन हेल्प टू आइडेंटिफाई द एरिथमियाज एंड वेंट्रिकुलर डिसफंक्शन. एक्को इज ऑल्सो इम्पॉर्टेंट इन हेल्प टू आइडेंटिफाई द राइट और लेफ्ट वेंट्रिकुलर डिसफंक्शन. Pulmonary function test or bedside spirometry is also important and it identifies the obstructive, restrictive or gas diffusion abnormalities. And but it is difficult to perform in critically ill patient. Bronchoscopy is important if you want to obtain the biopsies, brushing, bell for histology, cytology and microbiology. But it is it cannot be performed in critically ill patient. Right heart catheterization is important in case and it help to diagnose the patient with pulmonary hypertension, in which you can also measure the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, which is normal in case of acute respiratory distress syndrome, but increase in to more than 18 in patient with cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Management of acute respiratory failure. First of all, you have to admit the patient with respiratory failure in the ICU. The most important and the first step in the management of acute respiratory failure is airway management. Like if the patient with severe hypoxemia or altered mental status, you should go for endotracheal intubation. It is important because to provide the oxygen to the lung, as well as it help in removal of secretions and it ensure adequate ventilation. The second step after the maintaining of the airway is correction of hypoxemia. You can administer oxygen via nasal prong or face mask if the patient is conscious, or if the patient is intubated, you can go for mechanical ventilation. The goal of management is adequate oxygen delivery to the tissue, and you have to maintain the partial pressure of oxygen is more than 60%, 60 millimeter of mercury, and arterial oxygen saturation more than. Correction of hypercapnia. Control the underlying cause, controlled oxygen supply. Give controlled oxygen to keep the saturation more than 90% but less than 93% to avoid inducing hypercapnia. So the most common causes of hypercapnia, the patient with type 2 respiratory failure, you see chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, chronic bronchitis and emphysema. We can also go for mechanical ventilation. So what are the indication of mechanical ventilation? If there is persistent hypoxemia despite oxygen supply, decreased level of consciousness and hypercapnia, severe acidosis like pH is less than 7.2. The goal of management is to increase the partial pressure of oxygen, lower the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. It also helps to relieve the respiratory muscle fatigue. Ventilation assist or control the patient breathing. Positive end expiratory pressure or PEEP, and it is used with mechanical ventilation. It helps to increase the intrathoracic pressure, keeps the alveoli open, decrease shunting and improve gas exchange. नॉन इन्वेसिव वेंटिलेशन सीपैप इट इज एम्प्लॉयड इन पेशेंट विद एक्यूट रेस्पिरेटरी फेलियर टू करेक्ट द हाइपोक्सीमिया एंड इट परमिट हायर इंस्पायर्ड ऑक्सीजन कंसेंट्रेशन इंक्रीज मीन एयरवे प्रेशर एंड इम्प्रूव वेंटिलेशन टू कोलैप्स एरिया ऑफ द लंग. The main indication of CPAP is to correct hypoxemia. As the patient expires against the wall or gas flow into the patient during inspiration, the pressure in the airway should not drop to below that of the valve. This open up any alveoli that may be closed and prevent their collapse on expiration. The most important step after you maintain the airway and mechanical ventilation is the treatment of the underlying cause. Once the patient you have corrected the hypoxemia and hemodynamic instability, treat the underlying cause. If there is pneumonia or infection, you give antibiotics. If there is a patient with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, bronchial asthma, you can use the solbutamol, bronchodilator, ipratropium, anticholinergics, theophylline. Theophylline improves the diaphragmatic contraction, relaxes the smooth muscles. Or the patient who have the pulmonary edema, you will give diuretics. Other step, you can give a steroid in patient with COPD, eosinophilic pneumonia, asthma, exacerbations, fluid electrolyte management, IV nutritional support. It is also important to restore the strength, loss of muscle mass, and physiotherapy. It is an important. It is also important chest percussion to loosen the secretion, suction of airway help to drain the secretion and maintain the alveolar inflation, prevent atelectasis and help lung expansion. So once you have managed the patient, you have corrected the hypoxemia, the patient is now improving, you have corrected the underlying cause for the respiratory failure, you will go for weaning. So when you will think of weaning in the patient who are mechanically ventilated, when they have a stable underlying respiratory status, they are maintaining adequate oxygenation, they have intact respiratory drive, a stable cardiovascular status, and the patient is awake and is able to cough and breathe deeply and has good nutrition, then you can go for weaning from mechanical ventilation. So by now we have completed the management. Now what are the complications of acute respiratory failure? It could be pulmonary, cardiovascular, GIT, infection, renal and nutritional. So pulmonary, what are the pulmonary complications? It could be pulmonary embolism in patient who are mechanically ventilated barotrauma. Pulmonary fibrosis in patient who recovered after the ARDS or nosocomial pneumonias. These are all the pulmonary complications of acute respiratory failure, as well as in cardiovascular you find the patient may have hypotension, decreased cardiac output, arrhythmias, MI, pericarditis, and patient may develop stress ulcer, ileus, diarrhea or hemorrhage. Infection Nosocomial infection, they are also important, and pneumonia, or as well as UTI, catheter related sepsis. Patient may develop the acute renal failure due to hypoperfusion, as well as if you are giving some nephrotoxic drug to this patient. And the patient who have the renal failure, acute, who develop acute renal failure after the respiratory failure, they have poor prognosis. And also the patient who are on mechanical ventilation, they have nutritional complications, like they develop malnutrition, diarrhea, hypoglycemia, and electrolyte disturbances. So what is the prognosis of acute respiratory failure? It varies according to the cause. Mortality rate for ARDS is 40%. Younger patient less than 60 years has better survival rate. And 75% of the patient survive ARDS may have impairment of pulmonary function 1 or more years after recovery. Similarly, the patient with the COPD, the mortality rate is 10%. And it increases with if there is other multi-organ involvement, like if there is hepatic, cardiovascular, renal, or neurological disease. So we have discussed so many things about the respiratory failure, and I hope you understand it completely. Thank you so much.